हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी विल डिस्कस स्ट्रैटेजीज टू प्रिवेंट पेरी ऑपरेटिव ब्रोंकोस्पाज्म। प्री ऑपरेटिव आइडेंटिफिकेशन ऑफ पेशेंट्स हु आर लाइकली टू डेवलप पेरी ऑपरेटिव ब्रोंकोस्पाज्म हेल्प्स टू ऑप्टिमाइज द मेडिकल कंडीशन ऑफ दीज पेशेंट्स बिफोर सर्जरी एंड फॉर्मुलेट द बेस्ट एनेस्थेटिक प्लान टू अवॉइड a bronchospastic crisis. The areas of focus in history and examination. In history, we should ask about the history of smoking, how many packs per year and cessation time. Second, sputum production, the quality of sputum, color of sputum, diurnal variation or postural variation. Recent upper or lower respiratory tract infection. Then in history, we should ask about previous anesthetics. Then there is any history of hospitalization, intensive care unit admission, and ventilatory assistance. Then ask about history of frequency of acute exacerbations, time of last acute attack of wheezing, and ask about the history of medications. Serum levels of theophylline on examination suitably for these patients are suitable for regional anesthetic, relevant anatomical examination. These patients are suitable for use of supralaryngeal airway devices such as LMA, presence of acute wheezing and reversibility with the treatment should be assessed. Now we will see the timing of the elective surgery. Smoking cessation is the single most effective and also cost effective way for most of the people to reduce risk of developing COPD, and it will also stop its progression. Brief tobacco dependence counseling and or pharmacotherapies for tobacco dependence such as nicotine patches can be advised. The value of the pulmonary function tests remains debatable. There is general consensus that COPD candidates for resection should undergo complete battery. This battery will include force pyrometry with bronchodilator response, then static lung volumes, we should look for diffusing capacity, and arterial blood gases at the rest. This should be advised. Then we will see about the regional anesthesia. Airway instrumentation is best avoided in patients with reactive airway whenever feasible. Central neuraxial blockade, plexus blockade, nerve blocks should all be considered alternatives to general anesthesia. High thoracic or spinal anesthesia may also cause impaired ventilation by motor blockade and accompanying sympathetic blockade. This may result in increased airway resistance and increased bronchial reactivity. High thoracic epidural anesthesia, in fact, decreases bronchial reactivity in patients with bronchial hyperreactivity. This effect probably due to systemic effect of local anesthetic. The attenuation of bronchial hyperreactivity can be shown as a dose-dependent effect of lignocaine and bupivacaine. This is about regional anesthesia. Then we should minimizing the airway stimulation. Following tracheal intubation, mild to moderate bronchoconstriction is common sequelae. The exaggerated response is seen in patients with hyperreactive airways. May be life-threatening. Prevention or treatment of these response can be achieved by using either topical or intravenous agents. Inhaled anesthetic agents also inhibit the response. The avoidance of tracheal intubation is most logical first step in terms of limiting airway irritation and bronchoconstriction. If general anesthesia is required, laryngeal mask airway be preferable to endotracheal tube in terms of provocation of bronchospasm. Use of LMA has been shown to result in reduced lower airway resistance as compared to the intubation after induction of general anesthesia. This difference is assumed to be due to induction of reversible bronchospasm by endotracheal tube. This is about the minimizing airway stimulation. Then we will see about the topical anesthesia. A bronchodilator response to aerosol lignocaine in anesthetized subjects is observed by some authors. Lignocaine is probably a poor choice for attenuation of bronchoconstriction associated with endotracheal intubation. Then we will see about inhaled agents. Pre-treatment of patients with either inhaled beta-2 adrenergic agonists or inhaled anticholinergics markedly reduces lung resistance followed by the intubation. Histamine evoked bronchoconstriction as a model of reflex bronchoconstriction can significantly attenuated by albuterol or lignocaine inhalation. The combined inhalation of albuterol and lignocaine prevents initial bronchoconstriction observed when only lignocaine is used, and it offers even more protection to histamine challenge than either lignocaine or albuterol alone. The awake extubation results in bucking, coughing, and it could also predispose to the bronchospasm. Therefore, deep extubation followed by airway maintenance until awakening may result in lower incidence of respiratory complications. Depth of anesthesia during LMA removal does not appear to affect incidence or severity of airway hyperreactivity when sevoflurane is used as a maintenance anesthetic. Awake LMA removal during isoflurane anesthesia results in high incidence of adverse airway events. It carries the risk of severe airway hyperreactivity. Then we will see about the steroids. The preoperative treatment with combined corticosteroids and albuterol minimizes intubation evoked bronchoconstriction much more effectively than inhaled albuterol alone. This shows the in conclusion, we will see the strategies to prevent perioperative bronchospasm. Number one, preoperative identification of the patients at risk for the perioperative bronchospasm. Second, smoking cessation. Third, consider scheduling of the elective surgery approximately 8 to 10 weeks post cessation. Next, achieve maximal bronchodilation with inhaled or oral medication. Then check serum levels of methyl xanthines. Next, eradicate if there is any infection. Promote sputum clearance with chest physiotherapy and mucolytics. Then consider the steroid therapy starting 3 to 5 days preoperatively for refractory wheezing. Then continue or start beta-2 agonist, cromolyn and steroid inhalation up to the time of surgery. Next, anxiolysis, consider antihistaminic pre-medication, that is diphenhydramine. Consider regional anesthesia as a sole or predominant technique. Minimize airway manipulation or instrumentation. Use the supraglottic airway devices whenever feasible. Where intubation is necessary, pre-treatment with lignocaine can be considered. Intubate under complete muscle relaxation and deep plane of anesthesia. Use the anesthetic agent that are non-histamine releasing and consider deep extubation. Thanks. Thank you.